Linda presents this unabridged recording of
The Year of the Farmer, written by Rosalie Ham and read by Caroline Lee. The dedication reads, For the Hams, Farmers All. Here is a rural fellow that will not be denied your highness presence. He brings you figs. William Shakespeare, Antony and Cleopatra, Act 5, Scene 2. Prologue. Except for the busy nocturnal creatures and a light wind rocking the bushy gums, all movement in the camp had ceased. Evening had settled into night, and the people were asleep. One dog sat up, stretched, and crept to sniff around the smouldering fire. Others raised their heads and joined him, tails up. They milled together in the lifting smoke, ears and tails moon-tipped. One moved off and the others followed, slinking behind. At the river, they paused and lifted their snouts to the dark air, then turned and moved westwards. A handful of mongrel pets pattering along the edge of the water. As they ran behind the caravan park, a Labrador joined the pack, a fluid line of hunt-coloured ghosts moving with purpose. The dogs rounded the pump station and ran under the bridge, continuing along the riverbank behind the shops. No lights shone in the houses on the floodplain opposite, and traces of rabbit and fox slipped across the river to them. But the pack were drawn towards a bigger chase. Lust warming as they ran, blood on their minds. They travelled along the exercise track and over the levee and vanished, way beyond the swimming hole, past the hospital and the new service station, outrunning the westbound flow of the sluggish river to the sleeping sheep captured in their paddock and yards, innocent to the coming game. Chapter 1. Water and Sheep. The dust staining the thin sheet of clouds peeping from the horizon told Mitch the sheep were coming. He stopped the ute, tied the steering wheel to the rear vision mirror to keep the vehicle on course, and wedged a square of timber against the accelerator. He paused again to check the clouds sneaking up, then put the ute in gear and climbed onto the tray, the truck grinding along at a walkable 9Ks and the sun hot through his shirt. The hungry, thirsty mob hurried towards him, so he jumped onto the feeder trailer and pulled the outlet lever. The middle of the seed in the bin fell away and wheat trailed on the dry dirt. Soon the thread of skinny, unhandsome sheep were falling into line, like a zipper closing either side of the thread of golden feed. He pointed. Those clouds will slide over here, and water will fall from the sky. Tinker, Mitch's mostly black dog, understood many words, but there were none she recognized in the sounds he was making. So she turned her ear back to the gathering mob of dull sheep. I see you don't believe me, Tinker, but I'm reliably informed that weather works in 7-year cycles, and I choose to believe it. He climbed across and stood on the roof of his ute. This is my year, our year. Rain will fall and life will change. Tinker moved to the very far corner of the ute and examined the contents of a passing breeze. The ute kept moving, the rams kept eating, and Mitchell Bishop sat down, his feet dangling over the headboard. He reached for his phone and held it up to the meagre clouds, hoping a signal was passing. A lean, broad-shouldered young man in his prime. Expectation in his heart, despite the drought and his just mildly successful marriage. No marriage was perfect, and in the way of things, his would tick on until change presented itself. There were no messages on his phone, but Mitch's main concern was survival. Specifically, water. While his ravaged sheep nibbled with their tender lips and noses in the dirt and their own hard, dry shit, he looked again to the promising horizon. Rain would be good to grow a bit of feed, though it would have been better months ago at sowing time. His crop was poor, sparse, and starved, but that crop had come to represent survival. An adequate harvest could see him break even, just, though no income he'd get from his poor sheep or any sort of crop would dent his debts. He checked his phone once more, then put it in his pocket. As he climbed back to the feed trailer, his dog swiveled one ear to him. He shut off the seed outlet and drove to the yards to fill the bins for the next day's feed, then drove back to his flocks in the fire truck to fill the water troughs. He let the farm dogs off for a run while he refilled the fire truck tanks, then tied the dogs up and fed them and drove home. Pulling up next to his wife's car, he looked at the old house. Within its chilly walls, his father would be watching the morning show, and Mandy scrolling through Mitch's emails. He wished he had more sheep to go to. He opened the door and Tink jumped down off the tray and they paused to watch a vehicle out on the road roaring through the morning stillness. It was Cyril Horrock heading towards River Glen and Glenys Dingle, most likely. They would sit together in Glenys's shiny, dustless office and discuss the forthcoming meeting. Any discussion with the Water Authority meant announcements, and announcements meant changes to water supply allocations. In town, J.C. White dropped two slices of bread in the toaster, flicked the kettle on, and went to the back veranda. She unlocked the wood box, took out her .22 rifle and paused to inspect the churning grey sky and inhale the dusty eucalyptus air. Then she loaded the rifle and moved to the back step, where she stood in a sunshaft which cast her white hair golden. She trained the scope on the reeds along the low river. The riparian areas no longer shuffled and whirred with busy ecology. The long dry years had made the river gums still and brittle, and the birds had migrated to a richer place. Dieback had crippled their canopies, and where once great tree limbs had stretched out over a wide, strong flow, there was nothing, just exposed roots clinging to bare, sloping clay, hardened where the tide had receded. Sometimes the crash of a branch being shed echoed all the way to the main street. In the small flow of turbid water, one fowl and her three chicks were paddling towards the reeds. Along a low, fat branch of a thirsty gum, wild ducks were lined up, their little boxy heads snapping from side to side and their thin, flat feet lifting. The hen in the water turned abruptly and paddled away, her chicks following as fast as their small webbed feet allowed. J. JC moved her scope to the reeds. She found the black-rimmed red ears of Mr. Fox, watching like a sphinx. Then he rose, and JC held the crosshairs on his shoulder as he slunk across the clay bank towards the thick, slow stream. Mr. Fox put one foot in the water, took it out, but was drawn in towards the chicks. He swam delicately, his nose high, a gentle wake rippling out from his fluffy tail. JC held, exhaled, and squeezed the trigger, but the bullet punctured the water high of Mr. Fox's shoulders, and he flinched. The hen squawked and turned, wings flapping and water splashing, her beak spearing at the retreating fox. Her chicks swam in confused circles, and the ducks on the branch flapped away. In the kitchen, the kettle clicked off, and JC's toast popped up. "You are toying with a woman who has the patience of a gatepost, Mr. Fox." She unloaded the gun and put it into the wood box with the bullets, locked it, and hid the key under the mat. She ate breakfast, dressed, and waited on the front step, her name tag large on her left breast. The clouds had turned soft and flat and crept away across the blue sky. Galahs and magpies flew past towards morning business, and the rye grass fluttered stiffly with a passing zephyr. Two houses westwards, the Javetic family had heard the gunshot, but resumed their morning routines. Lana Javetic's father turned his small, sticky eyes to her.
"Home, today you will come to help your mother the potatoes to plant."
"I will," she said, and watched him struggle towards the back steps and his garden. These days, the old man moved slowly and stiffly up and down his rows of vegetables, swearing at the damage the fat rabbits had done in the night. Papa was beyond physically hurting them now. He hated his diminished status in the family, though, and remained a tyrannical presence. Marty said, "While you can enjoy, go. Do." Lana kissed her mother and left. As she crossed the yard, she lit a cigarette and looked at the grey streaked sky. At her precious 1990 Holden Commodore, she brushed the dew and soft white spheres of dandelion seeds from the windscreen. At exactly 8:10, JC and the rest of the river dwellers heard Lana's car rumble to life. She drove slowly down her gravel drive, turned east, and about 20 minutes later turned into JC's gate, bouncing over her stock grate and rolling up the potted driveway, thin borey fronds brushing her car. She pressed play, and the first bars of the song filled the car as JC opened the door. They sang, "You didn't love me like you said you would, but I loved you as much as I could, though you made me cry." It took 3:58 for their favourite song to play through, but it took them about 2 minutes to get from JC's to work. So they drove past the house where their friend Neralie had once lived and crossed the bridge and turned and drove on through the town past JC's IGA. They smiled at the men hanging the sold sign from the pub balcony, drove on past the op shop, then the hairdressers, Beau Monde, the deserted butcher's shop and empty frock shop, and the people waiting outside the news agency. They waved to Kevin, standing by a tractor outside his garage. The car turned at the swimming hole, where Larry Purfeet exercised his thin, languid greyhounds, and the morning walkers trudged. Some elderly folk with their Zimmer frames, the Rural Women's Club, and the Smart Set, with their blonde ponytails swinging. The blue car drove around and around the barbecue area until the last note of the rousing crescendo. I stopped loving you though I knew I could, because you didn't love me as much as you should. So now it's your turn to cry. Faded. Then the faster walkers in their tight activewear crossed the road to Maria's cafe for a skinny decaf latte. Lana parked in her spot beneath the Currajong outside the abandoned butcher's shop. Opposite, customers still waited outside the news agency. JC said, "Something should be done about that." And Lana replied, "You've been saying that."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.